Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio today is social justice. I would remind members, if they wish to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. I call question number one, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to recent statistics showing that the number of children in Dumfries and Galloway living in temporary accommodation rose by 67% between 2022 and 2023.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The number of households and particularly children in temporary accommodation in Scotland is too high. This is unacceptable and we are firmly committed to reducing it. In our response to the Temporary Accommodation Task and Finish Group recommendations published on the 19th of July, we said we would work with councils to support the development of targeted plans to reduce temporary accommodation pressures. We provide councils with annual allocations of £8 million rapid rehousing transition plan funding to support people into settled accommodation and £30.5 million for their work to prevent homelessness, with Dumfries and Galloway receiving over £950,000 in 2023-24.
Colin Smith.
We've seen an increase of over 90% in the number of open homelessness cases in Dumfries and Galloway compared to 2019-20. The crisis is so bad, housing officers are placing people in caravans and 50 bed and breakfasts across the region. So can I ask the Minister why the number of homes that were given grant funding in the year to the end of June as part of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme was down by 22% and the number of affordable homes started in the region is at its lowest level since 2016 when we have this crisis facing the region? Surely that's going to make it worse.
Minister.
There's a series of measures. I'll come back to the Task and Finish Group, obviously, and the recommendations. And one of the recommendations coming through, and which we responded to, was in terms of acquisitions. And again, that's something we'll be working on Dumfries and Galloway in that regard, and also looking at allocation policies. This morning, I had a meeting with the Task and Finish Group on prevention, and obviously, we're talking about that and coming forward in regards to what we can do in terms of prevention. So there's things we can do in working on Dumfries and Galloway in prevention at the moment. In addition to that, we also offered over the 5 years RPA, £106.148 million was allocated to Dumfries and Galloway. Some of the issues, obviously, is around about how we can maximise the spend around about that. There is flexibility in that programme to look around about temporary accommodation in that regard, and happy to meet Mr Smith to discuss that further if needed.
Thank you. Question number two, Evelyn Tweed.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact its programme for Government 2023-24 will have on the Affordable Housing Supply Programme.
Minister.
The number of affordable homes completed in the latest year to end March 2023 is the highest annual figure in more than two decades. Programme for Government 2023-24 reaffirms our commitment to invest £752 million this year towards Affordable Housing Supply Programme. Since 2007, Scotland has seen over 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than in England and over 70% more than in Wales. We will shortly be publishing a Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan aimed at helping retain and attract people in rural and island communities.
Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks to the SNP and Government, Scotland builds 13.9 affordable and social homes per 10,000 people. They do this annually, compared to 9.7 in England and 8 in Labour-run Wales. As the Joseph Rowntree Foundation has said, affordable housing contributes to Scotland having the lowest poverty rates in Britain. With the Tory cost of living crisis and Brexit pushing up the cost of materials and borrowing, how can the Minister ensure we continue to meet our challenging investment targets?
Minister.
The Member's right, it is an extremely difficult position at the moment. The hard Brexit didn't add economic mismanagement to the UK Government, obviously hasn't helped the situation. We've seen construction inflation of around about 15 to 20%. That's obviously including Stirling constituency. And that's caused, obviously, soaring construction costs. Despite this, the housing sector has done incredible work to deliver the highest annual rate of affordable homes since 2000. We're making £3.5 billion available to this Parliament. And remember, that £3.5 billion has been impacted by construction inflation as well. And that obviously goes towards the delivery of affordable and social homes. We recognise the need to keep pace with the demand for social housing, and we're making available more than £60 million from this year's £752 million budget to support the acquisition of properties to be brought into the affordable housing sector.
Supplementary, Ms.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I was interested to hear both the Minister and the Member's spin on this, because new statistics on Tuesday have shown that the number of affordable homes approved in the quarter between April and June has reached the lowest level in 10 years. These are the facts to it. So I wanted to ask the Minister, why have SNP Green ministers dropped their target for affordable homes to be built in this Parliament?
Minister.
It hasn't been dropped. And the reasons, and I've been going round the summer tour, most local authorities, speaking to private builders, speaking to RHAs in terms of this as well. And the key thing that's coming through, the two main reasons that are coming through, one is construction inflation. And again, we're looking at inflation rate within the UK, which is obviously an additional borrowing costs, again, caused through by the UK government's mismanagement. So these are the main reasons that are coming through in terms of approvals. Go and speak to them, they will tell you the exact same. Construction inflation and inflation rates and borrowing costs are why things are slowing down.
Question number three, Monica Lennon.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on progress with its Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, including in relation to its commitment to pilot universal free school meals in secondary schools.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann-Somerville.
Our annual report on progress towards meeting the child poverty targets is published in June each year and will include updates on actions taken on the delivery of the free school meals project. Through the programme for government, we've recommitted to work with COSLA to prepare schools and infrastructure for the expansion of universal free school meal provision to primary 6 and primary 7 pupils during 2026. And this will start with those in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment and will save families an average of £400 per child per year.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. It was back in 2021 that ministers promised to expand universal free school meal support to all primary pupils in the first 100 days of Parliament. It didn't materialise, and this majorly delayed manifesto commitment is going to make hungry children wait now until 2026, if we're to believe the First Minister. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in addition to what she said, when will we see detailed implementation plans around the timeline, not just for P6 and 7, but also for that pilot in secondary schools that is also long overdue?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have during this parliamentary session already seen expansion in the free school meals provision within primary, and as I stated, that will continue through our programme for government commitments. The Member's right to point to the government's commitment also to pilot in secondary schools, and the Cabinet Secretary for Education has been meeting with officials and engaging with COSLA on the issue. And of course, the discussions will conclude and something will be made public in due course.
Supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Is the Cabinet Secretary as frustrated as I am by the audacity of Scottish Labour, who criticise the steady rollout of free school meals in Scotland, when this is precisely one of the UK Labour pledges abandoned over the summer by Keir Starmer?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it has been a bit difficult to keep up with the number of commitments.
Cabinet Secretary,
have...
please resume your seat a second. If a member wishes to raise a point, they know how to do that. Otherwise, the floor is with the person who has the floor, which is the Cabinet Secretary. Please resume.
Thank you, President Officer. It has been rather difficult to keep up with the changes of policy from UK Labour, and that is concerning because clearly the fear for those of us in the Scottish Parliament is what impact that may have on policies for Scottish Labour as well. This government has reaffirmed its commitment to helping families throughout the rollout for free school meals. It is a disappointment that UK Labour leader Keir Starmer has refused to follow that example, and I hope that is not a slippery slope that Scottish Labour will now be on as well.
And supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
The point I was making earlier, Deputy Presiding Officer, was that that was a question about Labour Party policy addressed to a cabinet secretary. So I find that not in order, if I may suggest. So that is not what we have these sessions for. But why is it, the heckling aside from the sedentary position, I have the stats in front of me on school meals take-up. They're down on 2016. Why?
Before I call the Cabinet Secretary, I'll just say to Mr Kerr that if Mr Kerr wished to raise a point of order, he should do that. Otherwise, he should just probably ask his question, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I will be guided by you, by what is in order in this chamber, rather than Mr Kerr. And I'm afraid his crocodile tears and his concern for young people and children really are just that. From a government and from a member who backs the rate clause, who backs the benefit cap, who backs recent cuts to universal credit, and who supports the tax cuts for the richest, I'm afraid, Presiding Officer, that I will take no lectures from Mr Kerr on how we are trying to provide the support, as we are already doing, to children throughout Scotland.
Point of order, Stephen Kerr.
At your invitation, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'd like to make the following point of order. Is it in order for members of the Government Party to ask the Cabinet Secretary questions about Labour Party policy or any other party's policy, other than answer for the stewardship which lies within the realm of these ministers?
I thank Mr Kerr for his contribution. As far as I recall, the question was related to the social justice portfolio and indeed the issues raised in the principal question of Ms Lennon. I'm not responsible for the manner in which any particular government minister seeks to answer a question. That is obviously not a matter for the chair, but I was satisfied that the issue raised fell within the scope of the question on the business bulletin. Thank you. I now call question number 4, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what stakeholder input informed its decision to increase investment in social security.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we regularly engage with a wide range of stakeholders. In 23-24, we will invest £5.3 billion in social security benefits, which will reach 1.2 million people, rising to £7.4 billion and 2 million people in 27-28. Social security is a fundamental right, which is why we have established a radically different benefit system built on dignity, fairness and respect.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. I am heartened to see the professional input that underpins the Scottish Government's compassionate and ambitious approach to social security, but I am painfully aware of how efforts to tackle poverty here are undermined by Westminster benefit cuts, cuts that are now backed not just by Tories but by Labour as well. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree that it is likely the Scottish welfare model will keep having to mitigate UK Government welfare policies in the years ahead, whether that's under Rishi Sunak's Blue Tories or Sir Keir Starmer's Red Tories?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would completely agree with the premise of that question, Presiding Officer, and I can hear by the reaction that both Labour and Conservatives are uncomfortable by this line of questioning. I am not surprised. We have spent over £1 billion mitigating the impacts of 13 years of UK government policies, such as the bedroom tax and the benefit cap, and they don't like to hear about that, Presiding Officer. Meanwhile, the UK government are steadily dismantling the welfare system across the UK and enforcing a sanctions regime which is punishing the poorest members of our society. That is exactly the opposite to how our dignity, fairness and respect system in Scotland works.
A supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy President. I was slightly surprised with the Cabinet Secretary's answer when she said Social Security Scotland is radically different from that of DWP. Can she tell me how ADP, how children's benefits, how any benefit that has been so far devolved to Scotland is radically different in regard to the regulations that this government has brought forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't have time to go through that in detail, but I would love to meet Mr Balfour to give him the full details of that. But what I will say, Presiding Officer, is the Klein experience that has already been published in our surveys. If Mr Kerr is genuinely interested in this subject, he may actually wish to listen.
Members, please, let the Cabinet Secretary respond. Cabinet Secretary.
We are radically different in our application process, in the way that we work with stakeholders to ensure that people are encouraged to come forward for the benefits. And we are radically different in making sure that we are delivering the right result first time, which is very different to the appeals process which people are made to go through, and indeed the barbaric PIP assessment process which they go through with the DWP. A few examples which I'd be keen to elaborate with Mr Balfour in due course, should he wish to do so.
Question number 5, Alec Riley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what analysis is carried out of the barriers to achieving the National House Build programme for Scotland.
Minister.
The Scottish Government has set a clear ambition for the delivery of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, with 70% for social rent and 10% in rural and island communities. We have well-established partnership working with local authorities, registered social landlords and the construction sector to ensure we deliver the right homes in the right places. Scotland has led, as I mentioned before, the UK in providing affordable homes. Since 2007, Scotland has seen over 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than in England, and over 70% more than Labour-controlled Wales.
Alec Riley.
Thank you for that answer. I would refer to Shelter Scotland Director Alison Watson, and I want to quote directly her talking about the way we're progressing in Scotland with housing. She says, and I quote, "The snail's pace of delivery demonstrates clearly that the Scottish Government has got its priorities badly wrong and is neglecting social housing. No minister can claim ignorance of what that means. It means more children with nowhere to call home. It means more people trapped in miserable temporary accommodation. And it means Scotland's housing emergency continuing to devastate lives. Does the minister not agree that what we need is a national house build programme that takes into account the land that needs to be made available, gives local authorities the power to be able to get that land?
Thank you, Mr Rowley. We will move to the minister. We will now move to the minister for the answer. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've actually met Alison Watson twice this week, met her on Tuesday and met her on Wednesday, and meet with Alison on a regular basis to discuss that. And one of the key things I've been doing this summer is a programme of visits going round all local authorities. And the one key thing that comes through in all these visits is there are 32 local authorities with 32 different local solutions. Now, I've visited Fife on a number of occasions, meet Fife on a regular basis to talk about homelessness and talk about the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. So, you know, I'd invite them to ask, you know, the discussions have been going on around about that. Now, we've made £180 million available for Fife. This parliamentary term, that was an increase of £35 million. Part of the discussions I've been having in Fife is how do we maximise capacity and how do we maximise the pace of build in Fife in terms of that. So there are other barriers in terms of that. The key thing, I think, for me is discussing with local authorities what they need specifically in terms of homelessness and in terms of house building. And again, happy to discuss that in the discussions I've been having with Fife on that matter.
And I call a supplementary from Alistair Allen.
Over the summer, an announcement of £960,000 to support community housing trusts in rural and island areas was made by the Housing Minister, which is a welcome example of what's needed to boost progress towards Scotland's ambitious housing goals. Can the Minister say what role does empowering local communities have in ensuring we meet those affordable housing needs?
Minister.
Thank you. Again, I mentioned about the summer visits. I had the pleasure of visiting Gairloch just in last month to talk around about that and where we launched the funding in terms of that. And you see the difference around about what community-led housing could make in there, and it was really driven by the local community there. So community-led housing plays an important role in our broad approach to deliver more affordable homes in our rural and island areas. Many communities are actively engaged in taking forward projects within their own local areas, often supported by the Rural and Islands Housing Fund. That fund is playing a critical role in supporting community organisations and others in bringing forward housing projects who would be otherwise unable to access the mainstream affordable housing programme. The main thing about driving this is giving them the capacity to drive forward the project on their own. The recently announced co-funding support will enable the Communities Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing to provide continued advice and support to communities.
Question number 6, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much it has spent in the last 5 years within the Aberdeen City Council area to mitigate against any effect of UK Government welfare policy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Over the last 5 years, including this fiscal year, the Scottish Government has spent more than £733 million to mitigate UK Government welfare policies. Although we're unable to break this down by local authority area, over the last 5 years, we have invested £17.2 million in Aberdeen City Council through the Scottish Welfare Fund and discretionary housing payments to mitigate, amongst other things, the bedroom tax, the benefit cap and local housing allowance. Additional funding has been made available through Universal Credit, Scottish Choices and Advice Services. £11 million has also been provided through the Scottish Child Payment.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Would you agree that the £84 million a year spent on the discretionary housing payments could make a huge difference in supporting folk through the cost of living crisis if it weren't being spent mitigating some of the UK Government's cruelest policies?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is indeed frustrating that the UK Government plans to spend £100 million on discretionary housing payments for England and Wales in 2023-24, while Scotland, which has a tenth of the population, will spend over £80 million. If we didn't have to spend this money mitigating against the UK Government's cruel policies, it could, of course, be used further in our national mission to tackle poverty. I would suggest, Presiding Officer, that this shows that the UK welfare system, if indeed not the UK itself, is not fit for purpose.
I call question number 7, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government to provide an update on its progress in removing highly combustible cladding from buildings.
Minister.
Safety of homeowners and residents is our absolute priority. That's why Programme for Government sets out proposals for a cladding remediation bill to give ministers new powers to remediate buildings with unsafe cladding and seek the transfer of powers to create a building safety levy, which we're in discussions with the UK Government at the moment. We are undertaking a robust programme of single building assessments. Assessments are being completed and remediation is underway on one building. We are committed to undertaking a stock census to help alleviate buildings and explore ways to minimise cost and maximise revenue to ensure the programme can deliver its objectives in full, efficiently and in a reasonable timeframe.
Maurice Gordon.
I thank the Minister for that answer. A loophole means combustible cladding can still be used on schools and hospitals under 11 metres and on all hotels and office buildings. The Government is reviewing safety regulations this year, so will the Minister close the loophole?
Happy to discuss, happy to discuss that further with Mr Golden. Just a few things I wanted to add in terms of the cladding. There's been resident, consistent meetings with residents groups. We've also been working very closely with developers in that regard. We've obviously got them to sign up to the developer commitment letter, moving towards long-form contracts in terms of that as well. We have been regular in discussions with developers in that regard. Happy again to discuss the issue that he's raised.
In fact, two members have requested supplementary, so I will take both, given we have time in hand at the moment. Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My constituency is significantly affected by this issue, and a number of my constituents have contacted me with questions regarding their developments. And while I appreciate a different approach and solution will be applicable for each building, is the Scottish Government able to provide further detail on when homeowners can expect to receive communications about the outcome of their single building assessments, including a high-level timescale for any remediation work required, and clarity on where the responsibility for meeting costs will lie?
Minister.
The First Minister's mandate letter to the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice sets out a commitment to focus on supporting residents by ensuring that each of the buildings already on the pilot programme is on a single building assessment pathway by summer 2024. It's absolutely correct that the timetable and detail of work to be undertaken will depend on the circumstances of each individual building. I'm happy to meet with Mr McPherson and residents, as I mentioned previously, to discuss the specific needs of his constituents.
And briefly, Co-Capstewart.
Thank you. The Minister will be aware that I've been working very closely with my constituents in Glasgow Kelvin on this issue, and residents in a number of these buildings find themselves facing rising factoring fees and other costs as the remedial work is rolled out. So can I ask the Minister for an update on recent engagement by the Scottish Government with relevant stakeholders regarding insurance and mortgage issues?
Minister.
Yeah, as the member knows, we've met on a number of occasions to discuss issues. Joanne met with residents also in her constituency. I sympathise with the difficulty homeowners are facing. Regulation of mortgage lending is reserved for the UK Government, and we would expect any changes in the lending market in England to be extended to all nations of the UK. However, current arrangements are not applicable in Scotland, given the reference to UK Government funding schemes, which only apply in England. We have therefore been exploring what actions will be taken to provide reassurance to homeowners in Scotland, and I can confirm we are requested to be able to issue letters of comfort to homeowners whose buildings are part of the pilot cladding remediation programme. These letters provide factual information, and while they will not completely resolve the difficulties that homeowners face, they should help. I'm happy to discuss the matter further with the member.
And I call question number 8, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further information regarding the Minimum Income Guarantee Expert Group.
Cabinet Secretary.
The expert group includes people from academia, trade unions and poverty and equality organisations who bring a wealth of relevant knowledge and experience. Membership and terms of reference for the group, together with the minutes of meetings and papers prepared for the group and the group's interim report from March 23, are published and available on the Scottish Government website.
John Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. I was very enthusiastic to see the minimum income guarantee mentioned in the First Minister's programme for government the other week. But can she say if we will need input from Westminster to go forward on this, and if she's had any discussions with them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the expert group's interim report does acknowledge that the full potential of a minimum income guarantee may not be realised without full legislative powers. Although devolution continues to limit what we can do, we are determined to use the powers that we do have to the fullest extent. So we will continue to utilise those powers to tackle poverty and inequality. The recommendations from the expert group are very welcome. They take this into account, as well as the broader advice about what could be done if we did in the future have additional powers. And I look forward to receiving their final report in due course.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. And we will now move to the next item of business.